So, hi everyone. We're going for a drive today. I have a special guest with me. His name is Gareth Emery. He's a music producer. I've actually been listening to your music for a really long time. I'm trying to think what the first song I ever heard was. I think probably Metropolis.
Oh, you're old school. That was like, when was...
I don't know what year it was, but it's been a little while.
2008.
Was it really?
10 years, decade of listenership.
Okay. Do I get some sort of special card for that?
No. It's cool though.
Awesome. Well, we're just gonna go for a drive, talk about stuff. No real set of topics in particular, but should just be a fun little cruise driving the. So I have an inside joke. When I introduced this car to my channel, I passed it off as a Toyota Corolla Super Sport edition.
Yeah. Okay.
So even when I actually call it by its proper name, the McLaren 675LT, people are like, "Don't you mean it's the Toyota Corolla Super Sport?"
That should be a thing.
It should. And I think some people probably like full on believed me. They were like, "Wow, that's a really cool
Toyota."
That's
a sick looking Toyota.
I've never seen that before.
They went to their local Toyota dealership and was like, "Do you have the new Corolla?"
I wonder actually. There's got to have been like one person maybe who next time maybe they were with their parents at the dealership and they like asked the person there, "Do you guys have this the Super Sports, the Corolla Super Sports?" Knows.
I've got to say, those speed bumps back there were savage. So, will you scrape the bottom of the car if you go over those like straight up?
So, I have the front lift up right now, and I'm going to turn it down because we're out of the danger zone. I've not tried going over those with the lift down, and even with the lift up, I've not tried going straight over them. I just don't like to risk it.
Yeah, exactly.
People who are behind me on that just drive them crazy, I'm sure. And I try to let people pass. But you can't always.
I mean, given how fast these cars go, how slow you have to drive them in Los Angeles over these like certain bits of road is just hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure everyone looks at supercars and they think it's like always just going to be super duper glamorous driving them around. But really, it's a lot of just being really worried.
Yeah.
Here we go. All right, sorry.
Fucking hell, that is savage.
Take a break from talking for a moment there just to accelerate. So right now we're driving on Mulholland. Unfortunately, we're about to come up behind someone. We're definitely staying within the speed limit the entire time here. I guess it'll make it easier to converse when we're stuck behind someone.
It's probably a bad thing for me to be around supercars because I kind of decided to get out of that game about a year ago. I don't even have a car right now, but I did have a Lamborghini Huracan. And then I got rid of that, and then I got a Rolls Royce. The terrible decision. And
a Rolls Royce. That's quite the transition from Lambo to Rolls.
It was becoming a parent, and the Lambo is obviously many supercars are extremely difficult to drive in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And it was one of these things where I'd wanted one since I was 15 years old.
Right.
And I was like,
executing that dream.
I wanted this car since like 20 years. I wanted this fucking car. Can I even swear?
That's fine. You're good.
So I'd wanted this car for like 20 years. I had a little model of it when I was a kid. I could finally get one. So I got one. I ordered it like a year before it came out. So I had like a year of looking forward to it. And then it arrived and it just was completely not like my visualization of it was.
Huh. Was it like the look of it, the driving, the feel?
Oh no, I loved it. Like every day I stepped outside and looked at it, that was amazing.
Yeah.
And if I didn't actually have to drive it, I probably would have kept it a lot longer. I think my issue was...
If I didn't have to drive it?
No.
That's the weirdest phrase I've ever heard.
You have these long sections of straight roads that go through like farmland, so it's the perfect place to test out your 0-60 time, and I'm sure some people test out their top speed going down there. Obviously, I always obey the speed limit, but...
Of course.
Yeah.
That's as we're doing here today.
So I love doing that, but that was like a whole day. I had to commit to like 8 or 9 hours to go and do it.
Of course.
Driving it as a daily drive around LA just killed me, like, because obviously you're so low, the visibility's awful. Never quite felt safe with all these other idiots in like Escalades driving around like on their phones the whole time. Do you ever find that?
So it was your only car?
Well, my wife had one, yeah, but that was the car I drove to do my shopping. I took it to Ralph's to go and get milk.
Yeah.
Just driving up Sunset Plaza, I could see you'd literally take, not the racing line, because you're only doing like 20 miles an hour, but the pothole line.
Yep.
The roads in LA are generally quite poor for for the most part.
They are. Once you get outside the city, it's good enough. But inside, it's a real pain. It is.
I guess I had this thought in my head of what owning a Lamborghini was going to be like. And I imagined myself pulling up outside my favorite restaurant and being fucking cool and just enjoying the whole experience of it. Whereas in reality, I'd do it. And there'd be like people like filming me and stuff, and I can't see where the fucking sidewalk is because like the visibility is horrible. So yeah. I'm literally pulling in, like the anxiety of hitting the curb. Because I had one of those.
Please no one YouTube me hitting the curb in my Lambo.
Oh, right, because it was the new Lambo, and I'd one of the first ones in LA. I mean, I didn't see another one for about 2 months after I had mine. Yeah. So everyone was filming it like when I first had it, and I. Man, the anxiety it gave me. Maybe that's because I'm an anxious type A type person anyway, and maybe like you have to be a little bit more of a go with the flow kind of like chill personality to get by in a supercar, but yeah.
I haven't had the experiences of people filming me so much. Maybe if someone spots the car, it's definitely not for me, the person inside it,
right,
though.
Right, yeah.
And so I've had times where I'm like, okay, please make sure that you... I even get self-conscious about, like, how far away from the curb I park. Like, I don't want people to think that I'm a terrible driver who can't park close to the curb.
Right, yeah, exactly. Because then they're like, oh, look, he's got that fancy car, but he still can't park it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I mean... I don't really sound like it was all bad, because there were good moments as well. I had a few horrendous scrapes, just hitting things that were low. Yeah. So my driveway is pretty steep, as you just saw. So I had one very particular route I could use to get into my driveway. So I'd put up the nose, I'd drive in, but then I'd lower the nose back down again, because it looked much better when the nose wasn't elevated.
Yeah.
But I always had to remember to raise the nose again before reversing it out. And I had like 2 months or something, and me and my wife had an argument about something. So I was like, right, like screw this, I'm going out, jump in the Lambo, bang it into reverse, like I'll show her, go back. This horrendous crunching noise of like metal. I'm like, oh my God. And that time it wasn't just the, you know, they put the rubber, like the plastic on the front,
yeah.
It wasn't just the rubber. I scraped all of the paint off the bottom. I had to get the thing repainted before I
started. No kidding.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, the bottom on this thing, it's all carbon fiber.
Okay,
so. And so, if you damage it, there's no just painting over.
You can't even read
it. It's just, you either have to live with it, or you have to replace the entire, like, $10,000 splitter part.
Is somebody filming you at the back there?
I can't tell. I think they're getting the view.
Oh, okay.
The view is more exciting than we are. Yeah. Are we getting lucky? They're pulling off? Oh, they're pulling off. What a beautiful person.
It's gonna sound the lamest thing to say, but like the cars are also Instagram gold, like the most likes I've ever had on Instagram. Like, which again, I'll also be questioning. Like, I'll be like, damn, I should be like racing this around a track or something. Instead, I'm finding the most Instagram friendly backdrop for it. I'll be like, yeah, damn, that's gonna get like so many likes.
No, it's funny for sure. That I think the most liked photo I have on Instagram is actually a picture of this thing, and I'm like, because people like the cars more than they actually like me.
Absolutely. Yeah, my biggest hits on Instagram were my cars, and then when my daughter was born, she immediately became the biggest hit.
That's all. That'll work too.
But that is the reason why I got the Rolls, because I mean, basically the Huracan with a kid, complete no-go. They can't even ride in the front of a car.
You can't really put a car seat in one of those. No, I don't think it works well.
Once they're like 4 or 5, you can put a car seat in it, I also don't know if it's the most responsible like parenting thing to do. So, but I wasn't done with having like a fancy car, so I was like, right, what can I get? Which is still an obnoxiously look at me type car, but that is safe enough to put a kid in. Obviously a Rolls Royce is probably the most obnoxious look at me type car you can possibly buy.
Did you get the Ghost?
I got the Wraith.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so this was fairly recent.
Yeah, I got it about 18 months ago, and I sold it about 12 months ago. And that was actually an amazing car. It was beautiful to drive. It was fast as well. It was rear-wheel drive, which was...
Yeah.
They have to make them that way to make the rider that smooth, apparently. Which means that, like, off the line, the power delivery is, like, not really befitting, like, a car that engine size. But... beautifully, beautifully smooth ride. I mean, I'd like take it to Vegas. I'm doing a lot of Vegas shows at the time, and you literally, like after that drive, feel like you've been relaxing on your sofa for the last hour eating popcorn. It is so comfortable.
Yeah, I had a Bentley Continental GT up until just about a couple months ago, and it's not quite at the level of the Rolls Royce.
Well, they're faster though, because they're four-wheel drive, by the Bentley.
It is, yeah. Well, it might be a little bit quicker off the line. It's definitely more on the sports car side than the Rolls is. But still, with that car, you would think, okay, well, with a car like this, if you start going really, really quick on the freeway, it can happen kind of without you realizing. It's actually way more so in the Bentley, because with
it's completely...
or a Ferrari, like, you are feeling the road, so when you start getting fast, you're actually going to start getting worried. You're going to hit something and scrape the front, which is, everyone thinks, oh man, you got a supercar? Just blast that thing down the highway, and I'm like, I'm more afraid of damaging the thing, actually.
Driving a supercar at like 100 miles an hour, it literally feels like the wheels are going to fall off.
Yeah.
Because like, there's just so many bumps in the road at that speed.
Fortunately, if you get away from the city, it gets better, but like in LA, it's really scary to drive fast on the highway.
But you're right though, those sort of cars, like the Rolls, you just had no conception of the speed you were going because it's so smooth.
Yeah.
Off the lights, it was... Basically, the first 5 or 10 miles an hour was slow because it was shoving the whole car from the back. Mm-hmm. But after that, it would just properly pull once it was gripping the road. And it was just like such a smooth car. Dangerous, dangerously quick.
No, you'll just look down at the speedometer on the highway. You're like, oh God, I didn't realize. Oh, slow down a little bit. My bad. Uh-oh. Something's going on up here.
He got out of there. Oh, has it been an accident?
Yeah, it looks
He's
like
in the middle of the road. He got the...
Fire
there. Oh shit.
Doesn't seem good.
That doesn't look good.
No. Shit. Yeah, I saw the other day when I was driving home through Beverly Hills, there was a... Like, they just closed off Sunset. There was, like, I just saw a taxi and, like, a motorcycle both with
motorcycles are the one thing I've never done. Just because, I don't know. Not because I wouldn't trust myself on one. I don't trust some of the other drivers, especially in LA where people are very... I've never seen a place where people use their phones as much when they're driving.
Yeah.
Like, obviously, you never do enjoy something like this because it takes every bit of attention you've got. But, like... The amount of people just cruising along in really big cars,
like texting and stuff.
Having a text message.
I can't understand the text messaging. Like, how do you do that while you're moving?
Well, with great danger to, if not yourself, to other people in the world.
Yeah.
The PCH is one just makes me nervous. It's such a fast road, and the amount of times I've seen these, like, big, like, I always say, like, Escalades or Tahoes or whatever, massive SUVs. That are gonna fuck up pretty much anything they hit. Just like swerving out of their lane, you go past the person that's driving, and they've got their phone in their hand and they're tapping away.
Yeah, I try to be I live my life under the rule of trying to be as like little of a negative influence or inconvenience to other people.
Yes.
And so I feel that if I'm texting while I'm driving, I run too much of a risk of being an inconvenience to someone else, and therefore I'm gonna not do it.
What is that? Because you want to be like out of the way. You don't want to be.
You don't want to be that guy out of the way.
Want to be the guy that's getting beeped because the lights turn green and like you haven't moved.
No, I probably take it way too seriously. But like when someone honks at me because I've accidentally not seen a green light, because maybe I am like taking a pause and looking at my phone while I'm stopped, I feel so self-conscious and terrible. Like it shouldn't be that big of a deal to me. But I, like, think about it for the next few minutes, like, oh, God, I can't believe I just did that.
It took me some time after moving to LA to work out that honking is a more of a friendly... Like, in England, a honk is basically an invitation to get out and have a fucking fight.
Really?
Like you do not honk somebody unless you are really, really pissed at them. So here, when I first moved, I couldn't drive very well. Well, I could drive, but, like, I didn't know the road systems and stuff, and I'd be in the wrong lane and whatever. Every time I get honked, I'd be like, what? Like, are you staring? And then I'd put up at the lights, and it would be some, like, girl just happily sitting there, like, as if nothing has even happened. And I soon realised, sometimes it's just like a polite, like, yo, come on.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. Usually when someone has done something completely stupid and, like, cut you off, and they know it, and they make eye contact with you, I usually don't honk, because I'm like, you know what you've done. It's just like, oh, you're sitting at the light and you're actually not aware of what's going on. I'm going to let you know.
Exactly, yeah. It's kind of, I do know why people do it, right? Because obviously it's such a congested city. So anybody that arrives here and drives badly and slows down the flow does kind of need to be taught that,
yeah.
You know, it happened to me my first week. I was trying to turn, left onto Holloway on Sunset.
Mm-hmm.
And every car that went past, because I was blocking one of the lanes. And in England, you're kind of allowed to block lanes,
okay.
Doing stupid things. In LA, I soon learned you're very much not. And it's kind of other drivers enforce it by as they go past, beep, next one, beep,
yeah,
next
see, one. there are like places where you're allowed, for me, you're allowed to make a left turn, but I'm just like, I'm gonna be holding people up for way too long.
Some people will honk you when you're making a perfectly legal left turn.
They do.
Just because you're holding them up.
I try to avoid being that person.
So
again,
you're incredibly considerate.
I'm to my own detriment sometimes. Everyone watching this is like, you're just humble bragging about how nice you think you are. No, but it's actually how I go about doing things. I'm not exaggerating.
You like arrive late to stuff because like you spend like 30 minutes like letting people in front of you and...
Not to that extent, maybe. But I will arrive late to places because I can't find a spot to park. If I'm in like one of these cars,
yeah,
there might be a lot for wherever I'm going. Except the driveway is too steep and I can't go in. So then I have to text them and be like, I'll be like 5-10 minutes late. Sorry,
going
I gotta find a place to park. And they're like,
to find somewhere flat.
Yeah, they're like, what? Yeah. There's a lot here. I'm like, I can't park there. And they're like, okay.
I'm not quite as considerate as you. If I'm able to make a turn, like if it's a legitimate left turn, I'm like, hey, it's legal. Like, I'm fucking doing it.
Okay.
I love the hidden power. I like having a car that doesn't look like it should be fast, but it's
okay. And have you seen the Grand Tour by any chance? It's like the top gear replacement on
Amazon.
Top
gear, right? No, I'm not saying that.
Oh, so they have in the very, very last episode. It's not much of a spoiler because you know it's gonna come when they line the two cars up, but they're doing a drag race with the Porsche 918.
Yeah.
They faced off against a Veyron.
Yeah.
And then after they get that out of the way, they line up the 918 again, and they have this Nissan Patrol truck SUV that they line up next to it. And it just looks like a real, other than the racing slicks that you can see on the car, just it's a Nissan van. And they do the countdown, and the thing just rockets off the line. It beats the Porsche, I don't know, they're doing a quarter mile or a half mile drag race. It beats the thing by like 2 seconds.
And it's a van.
SUV, kind of like it looks like a safari truck, kind
of. Yeah, I'm on the other side on that one. I've had a few, right? I've had a couple of supercharged Range Rovers, which are scary because they go very fast in a straight line, but they don't stop that quickly.
Yeah.
I kind of feel they supercharge the engine, but they don't supercharge the brakes or anything. So, and you obviously can't go around corners very fast in them.
Yeah.
But the one I had that was loads of fun was the BMW X5M.
This was back in the UK?
No, that was here. That was, I think it was the first car I bought. It was the X5M. So it basically looks like a normal X5, but like, I like the BMW M series cars. I kind of find they're just good. They're good driver's cars. Not smooth, because the run flats like any other BMW.
I didn't know they have run flats on them.
Yeah, which is why they're bad choices again in LA, especially because like you get an SUV, even if you want it to be fast, you also do want it to be comfortable. And it wouldn't a comfortable car. But it was remarkably fast for an SUV. It was like 3.8 seconds or something like
was
that.
Was it sub 4, really?
Yeah, it was either 4 or sub 4, which for a big chunky SUV, it's kind of pretty cool.
No, that is for sure. I mean, even my Mercedes CLS 63, I think that was like 4.6 when I got it. That was 2012.
Yeah.
I think, but that felt quick at that point. So that an SUV now can do a sub 4 is kind of crazy.
Well, that Tesla Model X, I'm sure there's like an insanely fast version of that.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know their model numbers that way. It's like a P105 or.
Yeah,
like
so the P100D, I don't know if that's what the Model S is. I don't know if the X has
the
equivalent.
Oh, okay, yeah, I'm probably getting confused.
But the P100D with the Ludicrous, I don't know if you saw, but they did a software update like last week.
Like, they make them faster with a fucking software update. It's like,
it tweaks the ECU enough to be able to just take it that much quicker. 2.27.
That's unbelievable.
It's it is the fastest road going car to 60.
And that's the Model S, right?
Yeah. I don't know what the top tier is on the X, the SUV, but I bet it can be around 3 seconds. That wouldn't surprise me.
I think if, like, when I do get back into the car game, because right now, like, I use my Rice Range Rover, which is a supercharged, so it's still fast enough that it can give me a little bit of excitement. I think I'm going to go electric when I get back in.
Okay.
Maybe the Model X. I do like the
i8. Would you do an SUV, though?
SUV is more convenient for me because I can whack a child seat in the back.
Right.
And I also like to have something that I can take on, like, a long trip to Vegas if I want to do a long drive.
I don't know. The S seems like... Oh, does the SUV have more range than the car?
No, I think it's pretty similar. You'd have to stop and do like
the
250
Model
or something.
The Model S seems like it'd be a good... cover all those bases.
Yeah,
too.
I can't get on board with the look of the S.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know if it's like too smoothed out or something. It's just, I don't know if it's like not an aggressive enough look for me. For some reason, when they fatten it up for the X, I really like it. And it's also got the gold wing doors in the back, which is
great. Right. That's so surprising to me because the X, it almost looks like they took a Model S, put it into Photoshop, transformed, and just dragged it up.
They just made it fatter. I don't know.
And I've considered, and it'll be a long time out, because the wait list is 500,000 people or something, but the Model 3, the, like, more economical
one.
That they're rolling out soon enough, I've considered that would be kind of a nice daily driver to have, because, man, having that autopilot, just, if you want to go somewhere and you don't want to have to worry about manning the steering wheel, manning the pedals, to have that option, as much as I enjoy driving, I just think it'd be very cool to have in your back pocket.
Send you a text message while I'm driving.
Well, in the near future, sending a text message while driving won't be as big of a deal because so many of the cars will be driving themselves.
Exactly. Yeah, man, you make me want to get back into the car game. Like,
I'm sorry, I'm a terrible influence.
This is definitely a bad influence. I do love stuff like this as well. And I was never like, I'm not going to own a car again. I'm like, I'm just going to go from like having expensive cars for the last like 5 or 6 years to literally having nothing.
Yeah.
I'm going to see what life is like, borrowing my wife's car when I need something and taking Ubers. And it's been remarkably hassle-free, as well as like the financial benefits. There's this whole chunk of hours that I spend each week either, you know, driving the cars, sorting stuff out with the cars, paying for the cars, looking at new cars on Instagram and working out what I wanted to buy next. Like, it was like a large chunk of my life. Because I also, you know, consciously detached from looking at pictures of new cars because I knew I just want them. And I was like, wow, I've like reclaimed about a day every week not spent like in car work.
No, I'm terrible. Like, even the day after I'll buy a new car, I'll still be out looking at other stuff just because I enjoy it.
Yeah.
And so it does eat up a solid chunk of time. I enjoy doing it, but I could be more productive for sure.
Do you not find the anticipation is one of the best things about it? Like, honestly,
it is. It really is.
Those like 9 months or a year I got to look forward to having the Huracan was every day I was like, in January or whenever it was, there's gonna be a Huracan sitting in the drive. And it was something to look, like going on holiday, you just like look forward to it for so long.
Yeah, no, and I should qualify this by saying that I don't regret any of my car purchases at all. Like, I'm very happy that I've made
I wouldn't even, I know I'm saying I'm very down on them, but there was many moments of great fun.
Yeah.
And it was, I don't tend to regret anything, really. I mean, like,
and so, just like the anticipation, that is, it is a big part of it, for sure, and it changes the day you get it. But I still do very much enjoy having these, I should say.
I'm very much an impulse purchaser for most stuff. Like, I like, if I can't have it then, I don't want it. I nearly didn't get the Huracan because the wait was so long. And I said to a buddy, because any other car, I'd literally bought it, like, on the day. Like, the Wraith, I went and decided Sunday morning I'd like a Rolls-Royce Wraith.
Really?
By 5 p.m. I was driving one. That's maybe why it wasn't the best decision.
That's one of the few, like, manufacturers that you can do that with. Like, with a Ferrari, you can't do it. With a Lambo, if you want to have it spec'd right, then...
You can't do it, exactly.
Yeah.
But yeah, Rolls-Royce, you can. But yeah, so I said to a buddy of mine who's had, like, bought loads of, like, nice cars, like, before they came out. I was like, yeah, I don't want to wait a year. He goes, trust me. He said, that year, would be the best thing about it. Said you'll look forward to it every day. He's like, the anticipation period is what it's all about. So if I was going to do it again, I would definitely order early and like enjoy that bit of the process.
Yeah, the Ford GT is actually going to be the first time I will have spec'd it from the factory and waited.
Which is really cool, getting to work out exactly the way you want it.
Yeah.
I would really love, like, in my kind of bucket list, when I have a garage big enough to have all the Lambos from probably the Countach onwards. I like the mirror, but it was a little bit before my time.
Uh-huh.
Going up to whatever the flagship is now. So
you're definitely a Lambo guy.
I'm a Lambo guy. I mean, I like Ferraris, but Lambos have always been my part.
Yeah.
So, like, I'd just love to have them lined up. It's like Countach, Diablo, Murcielago, Aventador. Am I missing one? It's not been that many, I think.
No, you got them all.
Yeah, they last for a long time.
They're like an 11 year cycle usually. So even though the Aventador has been out a while, it's still got a few more years left in it.
Yeah,
sure.
It's gonna be a while till they replace it.
No, I've thought about it, that if things are still going okay for me, whenever the next Lamborghini flagship rolls out, that I consider it, because, like I was telling you earlier, the big thing that discouraged me from the Aventador was that single clutch transmission.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, there's the X5M you drove by.
Was it the M?
Yeah.
You must have a keen eye to spot the, because the only real telltale sign is the massive air tip.
It did. It has a bigger body kit. I guess I've looked at enough of them to be, like, you know, able to distinguish the performance
models. Yeah, yeah.
And there's a 458 Spider up in the latest as well. I saw when I was turning in, I don't have X-ray vision. You're like, how did he look? How did he see that?
You've got a feed from the top camera going directly into your brain.
Oh man, in the future, I'm sure.
You have like some contact lens or something that just like fucking beams into.
Have you seen Black Mirror?
Oh, you know what? I was just about to ask you that exact fucking question.
Have you seen all the episodes?
I've seen every one of them.
Okay.
Here's the thing, right? I've not seen any of it until, wait, we're doing a TV show. It's my new project, right?
Okay.
So we were having this session, they call it writing camps in TV. Basically just a bunch of people sitting down and throwing around ideas and stuff. And somebody mentioned Black Mirror, and everybody else in the room was like, oh, so good, oh my god, Black Mirror, so good. And I was there going, like, being the guy going,
you're the odd man out, I don't, like, know what you're talking about.
Well, no, I was like, yeah, it's good, I haven't seen more, but thinking, like, what the fuck is Black Mirror?
And then tried to play it off.
Yeah, I just, like, totally just, like, you know, glided through. But I love Charlie Brooker, the writer, and I've always loved his columns in the Guardian, the newspaper he writes for back in England. And I just didn't even know Black Mirror it existed, because I don't watch that much TV, which is why it's weird being in the world of making TV shows when I'm like, TV game is weak.
Right.
But I basically went and watched one, and within 2 weeks had been watched everything that I've ever made.
It took me, yeah, probably about a week, and I just love the fact that you don't have to go in order, you can just watch them kind of however you want. So I started off with the new season that Netflix did. And then from there I worked my way back to the BBC episode.
And how is your how did you find the difference between them? So I'm always interested to see how, like, the more bigger budget Netflix compares to, like, the low budget. I think it was Channel 4 stuff.
You know, I thought they were. You could tell that the Netflix ones were a little bigger budget. I mean, you got some more major actors in the Netflix one as well, but they were fairly comparable. I think for me it's more about what kind of thought it provokes than necessarily what the production itself looks like.
Exactly.
Although I will say that and I won't spoil it for people, but the most thought-provoking episode for me was in the Netflix one. It was that
Sandillo.
No, it wasn't that one. It was the military.
Oh, that was that one just tripped me out.
Yeah, that was a doozy. I was like, oh my god, can you imagine that thing existing?
That's not one you want to watch before you go to bed. Black Mirror generally is not a show you want to watch before you go to bed. But that one, I was on a plane and flying through the night somewhere long haul, and I watched that as like my pre-bedtime show. And the nightmares that came after it, like,
did you really get nightmares, right?
Waking up on a flight, like cold sweats, it was horrible. That was a trippy episode, though. I thought San Junipero was honestly one of the most beautiful hours of TV I've ever seen. I watched it 3 times already. Like, that show was just, that episode was just incredible.
No, and I'll admit, like, I wasn't quite sold at the beginning. Like, I think I started watching it, I was eating food, and then I was like, what does this have to do with Black? This is so weird.
It's such an un-Black Mirror show.
Yeah. And so I think I switched over to like watching The Office or something else. Yeah. And then I came back to it and I'm like, oh.
Apparently what Charlie Brooker said was, so I read this Reddit, Ask Me Anything. Oh, there's that phone. I read Reddit interviews. He was like, when they moved from the British production to Netflix, a lot of people said, oh, you're going to fucking Americanize it, you're going to ruin it. Like, I bet it's now going to be set in, like, California and stuff. Obviously, it wasn't. Most of it was, like, still set in England. But he was like, there's a fuck you to those people. He's like, I'm going to make one, which is going to be exactly what you are scared of it becoming. Uh-huh. I'm going to set it in California. It's going to be by the sea. And, hey, it turned out to be, I think, one of the best episodes of it.
Yeah. All the episodes are very, very thought-provoking.
I think that the ones I love from the earlier ones, I think it's called The Entire History of You, where they have, like, their contact yep. lens, and they can literally recall anything that they've seen. That one was brilliant.
It was.
And yep. There was a Christmas special they did as well, which I think is on Netflix, which is where they...
which one was that?
It's where the guy is... Without giving too much of the game away, it starts with these two guys in a place filled with snow, and they're like in this little...
Oh, in the cabin. That was like, oh my god, this is crazy.
It is a brain-melting show, though, isn't it?
Because it's set just enough into the future where you're like, okay, that seems far-fetched, but you're like, I could see the technology being able to reach that point.
What did you think of the video game one? Because that's kind of your world. Did you think it was completely like...
The
one where the guy goes into
the haunted house.
Haunted house, yeah.
That was that. It seemed like, okay. So I often wonder sort of where VR is going to get to.
Yeah.
And so it was something where I'm like, we're probably not going to get there anytime soon to where it's actually going to be like implanted into your head. But the idea of like a possibility for negative side effects happening as a result of things being a little bit too real. I don't want to get into exactly what happens again to avoid
give the game
spoiling
away.
If
people haven't seen Black Mirror,
yeah.
Like I recommend Black Mirror to people the way like I was recommending The Wire like 7 or 8 years ago.
Yeah.
Like it is that good.
So it is like I do wonder, like say you get into the VR becomes so realistic and you play like war games, for example.
Yeah.
Is it gonna get to the point where it's gonna start having lasting impacts because it's almost like you've experienced things so up close? And people will be like, oh, there's no way that it's gonna become that realistic. Well, would you have thought that games back when you were playing on NES are gonna look like they do today?
I mean, I think there's definitely gonna be an effect. I mean, when I first tried VR and did things like, you know, standing on the edge of a cliff, you definitely feel some of the fear chemicals or whatever
yeah.
they are, like, sort of popping into your bloodstream, and,
No, and so someone brought up to me the other night, and I feel like, I hate it when you see these articles on the news of people trying to blame video games for someone's action, like, oh, this person just... It'll be for like a school shooting, and they're trying to analyze the killer's mind. They'll say, "Oh, well, he played violent video games."
No,
they try to blame it on that. But you do have to wonder, like, is VR going to get to a point where it is almost going to be real life? That like Grand Theft Auto is, it'll almost be you are in there.
Yeah,
you have a prop in your hand. You can feel like what you were doing. I just wonder how far it'll go.
And to me, I think there's also the opposite argument to that, to the one where people say, oh, like, you play video games. Like, the human race has been killing itself basically since inception.
Yeah.
Like, sadly, we've been a pretty fucking violent breed for as long as we've existed. I mean, like, Neo Sapiens, which is us, killed out the Neanderthals. Like, we literally wiped out the only other human species that existed on planet Earth. Just like and in some ways, I think being able to get our violence fix, assuming it is a trait that's like biologically hard coded in us via like video games, rather than by actually doing it,
yeah.
like may actually have the opposite effect in some way.
It's certainly possible as well. And as someone who is not a psychologist, I don't feel qualified to really make statements on that matter.
Yeah.
Who knows? And then I also, you know, when it comes to just technology advancing, another thing that I also am always kind of pondering is like, you know, we're all super excited for self-driving cars. It's a really cool concept, but I don't know if you've ever seen this diagram of what the most common profession is across every state in the country. A truck driver is like number one in some, I don't know, I'm going to get it wrong, but it was like half of the U.S. states. Truck driver is the most employed profession.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, it's great when these cars are self-driving, super convenient, but what happens to everyone from that's their job? And then Uber, obviously, like, that's their goal. It's their entire fleet is just self-driving cars.
It's going to be tough, and, like, you kind of get into the realm of politics when you move down that road, but, I mean, I think part of the reason why things are a little bit crazy in the world right now is the internet has just completely changed the landscape of what people's jobs are.
Yeah.
And people that have had expected to have jobs for life that their parents and their grandparents might have done don't have those jobs anymore because they've been replaced by the internet or by technology. And the change of technology, like the advancement of technology, is happening so quickly, there's no time for people to retrain or find alternative things to do.
Yeah.
And it's not really a surprise that so many people are dissatisfied with life, because it's a kind of a scary place to be, I guess.
It is. Conversely, though, the internet has created amazing opportunity for the ability to do new things creatively, we're doing right now.
People like us, right? I mean, I definitely would not have had the music career I had without the internet.
Yeah.
It was where I got my first demos out, where I learned how to make music, where I hustled and networked and met people in the scene in the early days. I mean, even now, I mean, I'm not as big into social media as I was when it first started, because I try and put aside large portions of my time for actually, like, making the music rather than, like, talking about it. But social media has been an absolute game changer.
It has. No, and I was actually just, I tweeted this yesterday because there was this hashtag going on Twitter that was hashtag Internet Friends Day, some made-up Twitter holiday that people were jumping on. But back when I was in high school, my mom was, like, worried about me playing video games online and having the microphone on and actually talking to other people over the internet. Like, these are probably really weird people. Only weird people use the internet and do that kind of thing. And now, basically every single person that I know, either directly or indirectly, I have met as a result of being on the internet.
Yeah, exactly. I was kind of the same. When I was growing up, you didn't have headsets or anything like that.
Yeah.
But I was, like, big into games, and then that kind of became big into making music on a computer. And my parents were also a little worried. And then I started a business on the internet in 1999. Selling cell phone ringtones. That was a thing.
This was before producing. Or were you kind of doing it at the same time?
No, I was musical, but I was in a band at that point.
Okay.
So I hadn't got into, like, making electronic music. So I was, I started this company doing cell phone ringtones. One of the first in the world. Essentially, people would pay $5 to get a custom ringtone for their phone.
Was it a one-time fee?
Yeah, it was a one-time fee, and then it got sent to your phone via a text message. But the technology was so backward at that point, the way we'd have to, because phones didn't have the internet. There was no WAP. This was pre-internet on phones. So the way we had to do it was, you'd design them on a program on your computer called Nokia Logo Manager. Then basically, you'd plug your phone into your computer with a cable. It would send the logo you've created over the internet to somebody else's phone, and your phone would go, like, logo received. So rather than your phone saying T-Mobile, it would say, like, Nike or
so is this just a hack to change your carrier?
It was a hack, yeah. It was a hack to change your carrier, because at the time, all your phones ever displayed was the name of the carrier and signal and battery. So we hacked that, and there was a hack to, because back then also, you couldn't have a custom bit of music because your ringtone, you could, you know, you had, like, five little songs that came with the phone. Now, I don't give a shit what my phone ringtone is.
Nope, it's so funny.
It's off all the time. Always, like, on vibrate or whatever. Like, I don't even know what my ringtone is.
My phone has been on vibrate for the past 10 years.
If anything, a phone that rings with a noise kind of suggests you're, like, a technology Luddite.
Yeah.
But back then, cell phones were new and they were cool. And when you were rocking the new really dope Nokia, like, I don't know, the AEA50, which was a Nokia phone that cost...
Don't even know what that is.
It was a Nokia phone that was made of, like, silver and titanium, and even today it looked dope. It was absolutely tiny, and it cost, at the time, it was a staggering amount for a phone, like $700 or $800.
Oh,
now it's just what an iPhone costs. It shows the amount of inflation you've had.
But for what you get in today's phones versus what that had?
Oh, yeah, this was just, yeah, you paid for the design. It functionality-wise, it was exactly the same as a phone that would cost you like $100.
Yeah.
But anyway, basically, people that had that dope phone wanted a dope ringtone, so when the phone rung, they
everyone
could,
was looking at you.
Yeah, I used to buy cool phones the way you buy cool cars. Like, I was into phones, so then I made that my business. Anyway, basically, I paid off my college debt via this business. That's how crazy this world went. And from that point onwards, the internet was not seen as such a bad thing. Because it had become a business and I was making money doing it.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like when it comes to parents, if you're making it a job and they see the fruits of that, then all of a sudden they're convinced otherwise. But in the beginning, there's always that hesitancy.
Exactly.
And I remember, actually, I don't know what age I was. I'm pretty young, maybe like junior high, end of elementary school. But I would see these advertisements on TV that were for, you pay like, in the fine print, it'd be like $10 every single month, and we'll send you like two ringtones every month.
Yeah, yeah. Well, those like the Crazy Frog and all those guys.
Yeah.
And it was just going that way. That was just the point when I decided, hey, I'm enjoying making money from this, but I'm not really enjoying being in this world. I've kind of become, I don't know, I was in this like corporate startup type world.
It got a little bit kind of everyone's hustling and doing shady things a little bit.
And I just wasn't willing to kind of accept that was going to be my life. And I was like, shit, like 5 years ago I wanted to be like a famous musician, and now I'm like going to meetings about like putting ringtones on the back of my Coca-Cola cans, and it was cool, right, but it didn't really feel what I wanted to do. So I basically walked away from that and made very little money for the next 6 years as I tried to get into electronic music. And I was making tunes and sleeping in the same room. I had my bed and then I had my little workstation when I made tunes. And yeah, that was the next 5 years.
That's, I don't know, it's a testament to following your dreams, though, because not everyone is willing to walk away from... Not everyone is willing to walk away from something that's like a successful business.
No, exactly. And to be honest, I would have probably been more afraid to do it later in life. Mm-hmm. And that was the cool thing about being able to walk away when I was like 21, because I didn't have a mortgage, I still lived with my parents, I didn't even have a girlfriend, like, let alone my kids or anything. So I wasn't thinking, hey, like the security of other people is based on this. I could be reasonably selfish.
Yeah. Oh, even for me though, like I feel like I'm living life on the edge because I just decided the other day, after a very, very long time of thinking, but decided I was finally going to pull the trigger on making a channel that's more for, like, just live action on camera vlog style content.
Like, yeah, yeah.
And even for me though, I'm like, oh, this is risky, are people going to like it? But I can't even imagine just being like, I'm done with YouTube. Let's go do something else.
No, exactly. I also think when you make those decisions, it's always best to go on what you like, and usually other people will get it.
Yeah.
And there's just a more genuine passion that you can bring to anything when you're doing something that really inspires you.
No, I agree.
And I say that as somebody who spent far too long trying to second guess what other people want to see. I mean, I'm guessing in the early days, right, when you first started out, you didn't think, what does the world want? You were presumably just doing what you wanted to do.
Yeah, I was watching people who were making these Call of Duty videos. They'd get a good multiplayer game, and then they'd upload it to YouTube, and I was like, oh, I'm pretty good at Call of Duty multiplayer. I'll give that a try. And so it was just me emulating the content that I enjoyed watching myself.
Exactly, yeah.
And now, obviously, like, as much as you want to say that you still do everything that you want to do and it's your channel, definitely as you have more of an audience, you're trying to be more conscious of what are they going to want. Even though I really like this, is this something that they're going to enjoy looking at?
I think, and it's exactly the same in music. Like, the reason why so many great artists make their best work before they get really big is because they're just making it for themselves. There's no ego getting in the way. There's no managers saying you should make stuff like this.
Yeah.
And there's no feedback coming from, like, fans. They're just doing their own stuff. And then once you become successful to any level, you have a fan base that say, oh, we like this and we don't like this, it's quite easy to start trying to make stuff based on your perception of what they want. Or if you decide you're on a chart record, to look at what's in the chart and trying to like emulate what's in there. And I think from like a creative perspective, it's a mistake in any field to do that too much, because you kind of, firstly, you don't enjoy it as much, and secondly, you sacrifice your own like authenticity, which is always one of like the strongest things you've got.
Yeah, I would say that with your music, for example, like the stuff that you made in the past still appeals just as much, or the new stuff just, it still appeals just as much as the older stuff.
Right.
And so part of that, I'm sure, comes from making sure that you're staying in sort of a similar category as you go. For example, Saving Light is just as appealing to me as Metropolis.
Saving Light's a classic trance execution. And that one was just, we had the vocal and we were like, the way this song is going to best be completed is by making something really classic. We even went further back. I started full-time in like 2003 with Saving Light. I was like, I want to get influenced by like 1998, Ferry Corsten, like Armin van Buuren, Tiesto, when I first got into the scene.
Uh-huh.
We're going to make like a little bit of a throwback, but with modern production. I'm glad you're into that one though.
Oh, it's a really, really good tune. And I should, just as a nice little plug, tell everyone, if you want to go watch the music video, it's on Monster Cat. It was a pretty... Until watching the music video, I didn't quite appreciate what all the lyrics represented.
I don't think.
And now when I listen to it, I'm like, oh, that's... Yeah, it's a pretty serious message going on.
It was one of these songs that the moment it was finished, none of us could listen to it without getting fucking goosebumps and like even like tearing up at a few points. We were like, we'd never had a track that impacted us as writers so emotionally. And normally when you write a track, you hear it so many times in the process, any emotional power it has over you just gets lost along the way.
Yeah.
By listen number 1000, you probably don't get goosebumps anymore. But this we still did. So we were like, we have to make a music video that is as powerful as the song. I didn't just want to have like me jumping up and down at a festival.
It doesn't really fit with it at all.
Which is your dance music video 101 in 2017. So, I mean, the credit really goes to the charity gave us a big hand in constructing a storyline. Because when we thought we wanted to touch on the subject of bullying, we didn't want to do it in like an inauthentic way. Basically, we didn't want to screw up the music video, right? Somebody said, hey, like anti-bullying is where these lyrics come from. It's where the lyrics reflect. Let's make a video that is about that. And I was like, yeah, but like, you know, I'm 35 years old. Like, I've not been in school for 20 years.
Right.
I'm probably not the best person to write this thing. So we had a very rough idea of how it could go, and then we got in touch with the charity digital label and we're like, look, this is your world, you understand this, show us how to do this in an authentic way. And Lee Jones, our director, just did the most beautiful music video.
No, it turned out great. And then it first trance to hit number one on Beatport in how long? Congratulations, and for like a very good cause. And
thank you. Yeah,
message.
The thing is, I really don't like asking people to buy stuff normally, especially because, like, you know, stream it on Spotify, it's free, it's very easy. So generally, you won't see me going, hey, go and buy stuff on Beatport, like iTunes or whatever. But this just went to like number 6 in the main chart, which was already unprecedented really quickly. And we were like, hey, there's never been a number one, and it's for charity. Let's go and.
You know, I find people are usually pretty eager to rally behind a positive message. Like, I've done charity streams in the past, and I'm very constantly surprised in a good way at, like, how much people are willing to help contribute.
Most people, yeah. We had a small... There's always a small 1% that will just be extremely angry about anything you do that has, like, a level of success. But,
how dare you help people?
Well, yeah, it's more intelligent than that. It's kind of, yeah, you're just using the charity angle to further your own name and stuff. Hey, I wouldn't deny it. I was happy to get number one. I'd never done it before. So I was like, yeah, I'll fucking take that. I want to be number one.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't the reason why we did it. It was it came from a different place. But I also know there's certain people you can't really reason with. Some people will hate everything you do,
yeah.
regardless of how much you try and justify it and how much you try to make them like you. So I tend to ignore yeah. those people. If somebody's a legitimate fan who has a legitimate concern, then I'll kind of address it. Well, I spend the longest time trying to make sure everyone liked me, because I'm like a people pleaser. It's part of my personality.
Yeah.
I was not very good at making like selfish decisions for myself, and it generally doesn't work. Like, you can never make that happen. I heard this amazing interview with a comedian, Whitney Cummings, I think it was, who basically said that a lot of people that don't like you, it's not because of anything you've done. It's because there's something that about themselves that they're projecting onto you. Maybe they had like an ex that looked like you. Maybe they just don't like your name because they've had a bad experience with somebody with the same name. There's like many, many reasons that somebody doesn't like you. And you probably can't actually change them. So just accept that.
No, it's oftentimes a reflection of the person, for sure. And I mean, it ties back into like the bullying thing, and that your parents always tell you when you're growing up, if someone's being mean to you at school, oh, it's just them, honey. It's nothing you're doing wrong. And you have a hard time really buying into that. You're like, yeah, no,
it must be something wrong with me. But actually,
yeah. And then you grow up and you're like, no, that actually, yeah, that's true. Because they're later on in life, if you kind of hope that if you go back through on Facebook, the person who was a dick to you in school, like, they aren't doing well in life. and in certain cases, they're generally not. Yeah, it's been my experiences that, like, I didn't get bullied necessarily. I wasn't the most popular kid in school by any means at all.
I was very similar profile. I never really had any bullying issues, but like, my mother was a teacher at the school I went to between 11 and 15. So like, rule 101 of how not to be the coolest kid in school, have your mother teach you.
But when I would go back through and I'd either from my mom talking to other people's parents, because they still all live in the same city, and them gossiping and her telling me what's going on with other kids that I used to go to school with. The general consensus is that the people who I thought were kind of mean, like, it didn't really turn out well.
No, I've generally found that as well. What is the strangest one is when, like, people who, they weren't, like, enemies or bullies, but they certainly not friends either. Like, people at school that just wouldn't have given you a second look.
Yeah.
Like, drop you a message on Facebook and go, yo, like, coming out to LA, like, might stop by.
Oh, I'm sure you get that like crazy.
And you're just kind of like, I'm not sure you ever actually liked me back in school.
Yeah, it's like the, oh, now I'll latch on to you because you've done something for yourself kind of thing, which I've not dealt with myself, fortunately, but yeah, I can imagine in like a more traditional field, it's gotta happen every now and
yeah,
then.
Yeah, I just find it strange and weird.
All right, now we get to go through the fun process of trying to find a parking spot.
Oh yeah, this is, so you're basically, the street parking is really where you're limited to, right?
It's, yeah, you can't go into a garage, and it's like lunchtime-ish, so probably gonna be kind of busy. Well, we'll see how this goes, though. We might have a few block walk over to the coffee shop. Hopefully, you're fine after sitting still for so long.
Oh, I mean, you saw I live down the hill, but I love the reason we bought a little bit lower down the hill is that we're very un-LA in that we love to walk. So pretty much every day, walk down to Sunset.
Okay.
Usually walk to like Starbucks or Coffee Bean. Oh, here you go. Boom.
There we go. Kind of a shitty job by the car right there parking, but all right. Well, we're good to go. So, yeah, the battery on these things looks like it's gonna die soon. So, maybe we'll just wind down the conversation.
Yeah,
or we'll go grab some coffee.
Perfect. Let's wrap it up.
Yeah. So, thanks everyone for watching. Hopefully, you've enjoyed. And thanks so much for coming on.
It's been super cool. I like when you're like, literally just like sitting in a pub, right?
Yeah, it's almost like it's like a podcast in a car.
It's fucking awesome.
Yeah, so this has been great. If you want to check out Garrett's stuff, I'll leave his links in the description. And again, if you want to check out Saving Lights, I'll leave that link right at the top as well. Great, great song, great music video for a good cause. So yeah, hopefully you enjoyed this format. And
thank you.